Welcome to the Berks County Board of Commissioners meeting for March the 5th. We'll begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there any additions or corrections for the February 27th, 2020 Commissioner meeting minutes and budget and ops meeting minutes? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. I want to note that we did have an executive session on Friday, February 28th, dealing with personnel.
Talk about Johnny on the spot.
At this time, I would like to recognize Paul Jansen. He is the director for the Center for Excellence in Local Government at Albright College and the treasurer of the Berks County Water and Sewer Association. And he's going to provide an update on the programs available at the Center for Excellence in Local Government. If you want to step up to the microphone, very good to have you, Paul. You walked in at the perfect moment.
I would say that was timing. Thank you very much for allowing me to have an opportunity to talk today and inviting me here. I want to start out by formally thanking you for all of the assistance that the commissioners have given us over the years, but particularly the financial support that you give the center that allows us to do the programming that we're doing. We're very excited about what's happening now in Berks County with our local governments. We have a couple of major initiatives that we're dealing with. Hopefully that will help our local governments and the county as we meet the challenges of government moving forward. Our annual dinner is on March 26th, and the speaker for that event is a gentleman who is very well versed in what's happening with firefighting in Pennsylvania. And I think all of you know, firefighting is becoming a very big issue that we have to deal with as our volunteers in the fire service in Pennsylvania have dwindled from over 300,000 in the 70s to now we're slightly over 30,000 active volunteers. That's an issue that's hitting us here in Berks County as we see more and more municipalities having to go to career firefighters, and that's an expensive endeavor once you have to start that process. So our dinner topic is going to be on the future of firefighting in Berks County. We have two other initiatives that we're working on right now. One of them deals with economic development and what local governments can do to assist in ensuring that we have an opportunity to do good economic development. That's an initiative that's being shared with the Water and Sewer Association and with the Berks Municipal Partnership. But you know, we have a huge resource here in Berks County in that we have a lot of excess water in certain areas, and so we can market that water if we work that process correctly. But we're also trying to work with our local officials to understand what they can do to assist in that process. Obviously, if we get economic development through industrial and commercial development, it has a great financial impact on the municipalities and on the school districts for financing purposes. So we're very excited about that. I guess on June 5th, we have our fifth annual golf outing, which is a pretty good time for everybody to get together. And that will be the cap off of our programming for the 1920 cycle. Then we begin the 2021 cycle with the Berks County Water and Sewer Annual Conference. And that's going to have a couple of topics. One of which is about water quality and what we're doing to ensure that we have good quality water in Berks County. The other topic is cybersecurity, which is getting a lot of attention in municipalities across the Commonwealth now. So we're very excited about what we're doing there, and we're again very excited about all the support that you give the center. So Each of you has an assignment with the center, and all of you are very active in that, so we're very appreciative of that. Are there any questions you have for me?
Yep.
Just keep up the good work.
The other thing I would highlight are the spring and fall municipal leaders breakfast that we do. You host that. Fred Levering normally facilitates that, and we enjoy attending it. We normally share a brief update and then do question and answer from our municipal leaders across the county.
If you don't mind, I'd like to make a comment about that. You know, I spent a career in municipal government, and I managed municipalities all around the suburban counties of Philadelphia. And I've been involved through the Association of Pennsylvania Municipal Managers and through the League of Municipalities. And I can tell you that nowhere else in the Commonwealth that I'm aware of do commissioners make themselves available to local government like you do here in Berks County. You know, I don't think any commissioners anywhere else that I'm aware of would go into a breakfast without a preset presentation, and I'm not taking any questions. Mm-hmm. And in these events, you take any question, all three of you take any question, and you deal with it. And there's a huge trust that occurs between municipal government and Berks County commissioners because of that. And I think it is very helpful that that those events occur you know, twice a year, and that you make yourselves available to local government. So it's a two-way street.
The first one is next week.
That's why I was going to say the first one's coming up next week.
That's why I sit near the door just in case somebody gets rowdy. I can leave and get in my car. On a personal note, I want to thank you and the staff at the center for now the third census and stepping forward and handling the management of the staff, putting out cards such as this, conducting the meetings, and really making this a real great effort to count everybody on April 1st, 2020. And it's in large part to your direction out there at the center.
It's hard to believe that, you know, we had a kickoff event on April 1st, 2019, and now we're within 4 weeks of our census date. I would encourage everybody to look to the census Facebook page that we have on the Center for Excellence in Local Government. We are working very hard to make internet availability to individuals that don't have that accessibility. Places all over Berks County will be hosting locations where you can go if you need to log onto the computer to do your census information. And you know, shout out to the library system here in Berks County, because they've been tremendous, especially the library here in the city of Reading. They've really worked hard to make sure that nobody will not have the ability to get to a computer so they can fill out their form. And you know, I think we've talked about it a lot. I hope everybody recognizes that the vast majority of the census is going to be done by logging onto a computer and filling out 10 questions, as opposed to what it has been since I can remember, which is getting a form at home and filling it out. So there are sections in Berks County that will get written forms, and you can fill it out that way. We're posting on the website what that letter will look like if you get your letter that gives you your code to log on, and also what the census questionnaire will look like if you actually get the census questionnaire. So,
thank you, Paul.
Very good.
Thank you, Commissioner Barnhart, for all your leadership in that area also.
So, you're welcome.
I guess I should say that Commissioner Rivera is on the Berks Municipal Partnership, Commissioner Leinbach is on the Berks County Water and Sewer Association, and Commissioner Barnhart is the chairman of the Community Advisory Board for the center. So we appreciate all of your involvement in all of that.
Welcome.
Very good. Thank you very much,
Thank
Paul.
You.
Excellent. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you.
Is there any public comment on specific agenda items? Seeing none, we'll move to the agenda.
Did you do the minutes?
Yeah, I did. I did them before Paul got here. I was buying in time to walk in the door. So, under authorizing budget department, adopt a resolution authorizing 2019 appropriations in the negative amount of $165,000, 2020 budget transfers in the amount of $61,935, and 2020 appropriations in the amount of $338,885 per listing dated March 2nd of 2020. Under Human Resources, we have three items. Item one, authorize the appointment of Daniel Jenkins to Manager of Financial Reporting and Accounting in the Office of Controller. Item two, authorize the salary adjustment for Deborah Oliveri, Director of Election Services. Item three, authorize a Commissioner's Lump Sum Award for the Director of Election Services in the amount of $2,000. And I want to highlight this. We rarely, I'm not exactly sure the last time we've done this. It's been years. But Debbie Oliveri oversaw the acquisition and implementation of brand new voting machines last year. They were tested in the primary, and they were in a number of different polls where people could go in and try them out. But they were first utilized in the general election. If you followed some other counties that implemented new voting machines, it wasn't uncommon that there were difficulties in some of those other counties. Debbie did a tremendous job along with her staff, and this is not something that's done on a regular basis. The last time Berks County had new voting machines was a little over 30 years ago. So this is a significant, above and beyond the normal duties of her role as a director, and so we wanted to recognize her in that fashion. Purchasing. We have several items. Adopt a resolution authorizing the award and the Director of Contracts and Procurement to execute as a result of an invitation to bid a one-year contract for processing and marketing of recyclable materials. The award goes to Solid Waste Services, Inc., doing business as J.P. Mascaro and Sons. The total estimated annual expenditure is $20,125. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the award and the Director of Contracts and Procurements to execute two agreements as a result of an invitation to bid, inmate and resident clothing rebid for a period of 1 year for the participating members of the Southeastern PA County's Cooperative Purchasing Board. The one company is Bob Barker Company, Inc., and the Berks portion is $37,493.97, and then JAB Trading Industries, and the Berks portion of that contract is $12,483.50. There are several items listed under Commissioners. Adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the agreement for professional services between the County of Berks and May, Conard, and Rotenberg, LLP out of Wyomissing, PA, to provide legal services as court-appointed parent counsel for clients requiring representation in proceedings involving the Berks County Children and Youth Services Agency for a one-year term expiring December 31st of 2020. Item B, adopt a resolution approving and authorizing execution of the drawings authorizing acquisition of right-of-way as prepared by Van Cleef Engineering Associates and Malik and Scher PC pertaining to parcels of land affected by the Glendale Bridge Project in Douglas Township. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Terry C. Lampe-Melcher, Birdsboro, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Industrial Development Authority for a five-year term expiring December 31st of 2024. Item two, a motion authorizing execution of contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator as set forth on the attached listing dated March 2nd of 2020. There is one contract and it is with facilities and operations. And then finally, a motion to ratify and confirm payments as set forth on Controller's Office voucher listing dated March the 3rd of 2020 for the week ending March the 4th of 2020 and the payment of electronic transfers and employee payroll.
Motion to approve the agenda is presented.
Second.
The motion has been made to approve the agenda. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion is carried. With that, we'll turn to Dennis Adams, our county treasurer, with the treasurer's report.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We have an opening balance today of $148,721,545.85. A balance to clear of $4,355,964.89, leaving us with a balance today of $144,365,580.96.
Thank you very much, Dennis. And Sandy Graffius, our county controller, with the controller's report.
Our total accounts payable is $7,406,712. We had a payroll this week of $4,514,581 for a grand total of $11,921,293.95.
Thank you very much. And with that, we'll turn to our CFO, Bob Patrizio, with this afternoon's budget and ops agenda.
Morning, Commissioners. Welcome back.
Thank you.
The two of you. We do have a meeting today. It starts at 2 p.m. We'll be going over the adopted budget five-year forecast. We have a facility discussion focused on courthouse entrance doors and Muhlenberg Green, a revised Ag Center scope of work related to the Fed's request for a lease proposal. And that'll be followed by a constable audit scope of work, firm selection questions that have been posed, and also CGL discussion, which our solicitor asked to add on for today.
All right. Very good. Thank you. Well, our Chief Administrative Officer, Ron Seaman.
The only thing I have to offer is that in addition, at the end of that exhaustive list, there'll be a brief discussion on our approach to the coronavirus.
Okay. And with that, we will turn to commissioners. Commissioner Barnhart.
Thank you, Commissioner Linebach. In keeping with trying to make our polling locations as accessible to the folks, we are presently have an RFP out on the street, an ADA survey of our polling places. The deadline to submit is March 9th. And really, it's I'm going to read just briefly. The Berks County Board of Commissioners is interested in engaging a consultant to conduct an accessibility study of the 202 polling places in Berks County. Purpose of the request is to assess the experience and interest of entities in conducting accessibility surveys under the Americans with Disabilities Act, as amended, for the interior and exterior space of the county's polling places. Response to this RFP weighed the county in determining experience and level of interest of potential consultants and making an informed decision as to which consultant to engage. We are looking for a firm to review the 202 polling places for compliance with ADA compatibility, and then ultimately put this into a plan of action potentially over the next 4 to 5 years as we can afford to make these changes, and all in keeping with getting as many folks out to vote as humanly possible and not trying to restrict that access. So if anyone knows of a firm that might be interested in this, it's available on the Election Services website, or you can contact my office as well. Deadline's a little short. We're trying to get this done before June, so we can then budget for this in the out years and recognize that this is something that's necessary in Berks County to keep our elections open and fair to everyone. Last but not least, a reminder tonight is the Black Balloon event, the third annual Black Balloon event in support of opioids awareness, SOS Berks. The Murray family has done a tremendous job with this. It's 4:30 to 8 o'clock at the Shillington Farmers Market. So come on out, it's only $15, all you can eat food. Really, this money last year that was raised helped the SOS Berks Opioids Coalition build its website. So every penny made at this event goes back into awareness, treatment, and prevention of opioids in Berks County, because the family lost a son and brother to an opioids overdose about 10 years ago. So please come on out, even if you stop and get a takeaway platter for $15, it really all goes for a good cause. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Rivera.
Yep. Thank you, Commissioner Linebach. Commissioner Linebach and I just got back yesterday from NACO. They had their 2020 legislative conference, Washington, D.C., and that's the National Association of Counties. I had various takeaways, very interesting, learned a lot there, it was a great opportunity. One of the things we were able to hear from General Colin Powell, he spoke on leadership, and one of the interesting things I heard there was that we should examine our failures, see what we did wrong, fix it, and then throw that to the trash and move on. A lot of times when we fail, we just think about it, well, why did I do this? And you just keep dwelling on it. You know what? He says, what did he do wrong? How are you going to fix it? Fix it, and then throw it on the trash and keep moving forward, because we're all going to make mistakes at one point or another. That's just part of life and part of us growing professionally and personally. Also, I had the opportunity to hear from the Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, Ben Carson. He says the biggest challenge they're looking at right now is affordable housing. He stated that the cost of building a single-family home, on average, it's 25 to 27% of the cost is due to regulations. So just getting through the hurdles of regulations. And when you're looking at building a multifamily home or apartments, it's a 42% of the cost is due to regulations. So they're looking at what they can do right now to try to minimize that, to make housing more affordable. And one of the things he mentioned is that as you update regulations, well, you have to update regulations as times change, but rather than just continuing to add them on to old regulations, you need to look at what's old and see how you can actually make updates that fit the times that we are in. And another issue around housing that many counties are having is the backlog of people that are in need of Section 8 housing. And that's one of a few reasons. One of them is that they're stating that there's really not a, due to the affordable housing issue, there's not a next step in which working families can go into to be able to leave Section 8, to leave others that are more need to be able to have access to that. So right now they're looking at seeing at the federal level what could be done there as well. And they're proposing updates to the CRA, the Community Reinvestment Act guidelines as well, to help have a bigger impact on this type of affordable housing. So those are some things that the administration is looking at the federal level to help out with affordable housing. Also want to congratulate Ernie Post, who's the director of the Pennsylvania Small Business Administration. It was Alan Gutierrez, who's the assistant, I'm sorry, the associate administrator of the Office of Entrepreneurial Development of the Small Business Administration. Him and in another workshop as well, they pointed out the great work that the Kutztown University Small Business Development Center is doing, as well as the entire state and the Latino Business Resource Center for the opportunities that and the resources that they provide for people who speak Spanish. They're a model throughout the country in that aspect. So congratulations to Kutztown, congratulations to the SBDC, and to Ernie Post. And one last thing, there are three items or three initiatives that that interested me from listening to what other counties are doing across the United States, and there are three things that I want to work on. I'm not going to mention them now. I do want to do a little bit of more of research and see how that might be able to fit into Berks County, and I will update you on that as time moves forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Rivera. Couple of items. With the NACO conference, there's a lot that we could share. One of the major announcements was the presentation of a report with recommendations. It was a joint presentation between the National Association of Counties and the National Association of Sheriffs. And it has to do with the, I believe, constitutional issue of individuals who are accused of a crime and are sent to jail waiting their trial. If they're a veteran, they lose their veterans benefits the minute they walk across the threshold of the jail. If they're on Medicaid or Medicare, they lose those benefits as soon as they go step across the threshold. The National Sheriff's Association and NACO are working with federal legislators and the administration to address this issue. It's a constitutional issue because in America, unlike many other countries, you're innocent until you're proven guilty. And this strategy, A, assumes they're guilty. They're having a benefit pulled back. it not only assumes they're guilty, guess who pays when they walk across the threshold? Everyone in the jail is, all their health care, any issue that comes up is paid for by local taxpayers through your local property tax. Most people are not aware of that. This was a significant issue. I can tell you that NACO leadership, which I'm on the leadership team, we're actually considering, if we don't get some movement pretty quickly, a federal lawsuit challenging the federal government for violation of the constitutional rights, that innocence is presumed. So keep an eye on that, but it is very good to be able to work with the National Sheriff's Association. I forget the gentleman's name, but he addressed our NACO Board of Directors, and he also was in one of the sessions and made a presentation. As Michael Rivera noted, we heard from a number of different speakers on both sides of the aisle on a variety of issues. General Colin Powell was very fascinating and had some extremely practical insight on leadership. President Trump spoke on Tuesday. I will tell you it, and I don't mean this in a negative way, but it fundamentally disrupted the schedule for the day. That happens. The building was largely, access to the building was largely closed down 10:30 a.m. that morning. He didn't speak until about 11:20 a.m. and the building was not opened back up until he was in the motorcade and away from the building. The place was packed. I will tell you, it was impressive watching Donald Trump interact with the crowd. He knew that he had a bipartisan crowd, but NACO looked at it from this perspective. Every single legislative conference, actually every conference, even our annual, we always invite the sitting president to come and address the association. I think I mentioned this before. The last president to accept an invitation to address the entire association was President Bill Clinton. And over 8 years, he did it three times. If you are interested in history, Bill Clinton's presidency is worth a very careful look, because whether you agreed or disagreed with his politics, he understood how to work with people. And he understood the value of connecting with 3,069 counties across the country. And I would tell you that since then, the next two administrations, neither one, Bush, I call Bush 43, separating from Bush 41, and President Obama, neither one accepted the invitation to speak to our group. It was fascinating. Donald Trump, as he spoke, he had told us in advance, or his team, that he kind of reacts to the audience. And if the audience is tough, it's going to be a shorter speech. If the audience is really reacts well, interacts well, it'll be a longer speech. It was supposed to be a 20-minute speech. It was almost an hour. And one of the things that happened that shocked him, and for me, it's the first time I've seen a president acknowledge, wow, that surprises me. He took a stand on the problem of mental health in county jails, that this is the wrong way to deal with mental health, and that his administration is committed to addressing that and working with the counties. He got the longest and most vigorous standing ovation from everyone. And I have not yet posted it, but I actually have a video of that clip, his statement, and where I went all around the room, and you can see people clapping, cheering. And then he said, wow, I didn't think that would get that kind of reaction. And that's important because it helped him understand the counties are frustrated. When we look at our county jails, our jail is a little over 900 population. right around 100 people in our jail are SMI, severely mentally ill, many of them one to a cell, many of them requiring 15-minute checkups. And our corrections officers, apart from internal training, they're there in the criminal justice system. They are not mental health professionals. But we have another almost 500 people in the county jail that are either in active mental health treatment and or on psychotropic medications. It's over 65% of your population. We've got to deal with the mental health issue. The way the government dealt with it in the late 70s and 80s, they closed most of the mental health facilities in America. And most of those people were just dumped out onto the streets. It's a serious issue. Again, a lot of us were very impressed. I had the unique opportunity with our 8-member executive committee to be able to talk to the president before he went out to speak. We have our 4 officers, our immediate past president, president, vice president, and second vice president, and then our 4 regional representatives. I represent the Northeast. There's a representative for the South, representative for Central U.S. and Western. Many of you know I had surgery a week and a half ago, and every day since that surgery, my mother's called me to see how I'm doing. She's 93 years old, and it was either Monday or Sunday night I told her that President Trump is going to be speaking, and I might get an opportunity to meet him. She said to me, "Would you do me a favor? If you get to talk to him, would you tell him that your 93-year-old mother prays for him by name every day?" I said, "I'll try to do that." And when I met President Trump, because it was such a short period of time, I didn't even have a chance to introduce who I was. I just simply said to him, "President Trump, my 93-year-old mother asked me to tell you that she prays for you by name every single day. And I'll let you in a little secret. She prays for the Supreme Court, for the president, for the vice president, for her senators, for her congressmen. She prays for her county commissioners. She lives in Schuylkill County every single day." That's what I shared with him. He looked at me and said, "Thank her for me." It was really a great event. I have a number of items that I'm going to be sharing with some different departments that I think can be beneficial to our county. But once again, NACO put together a very worthwhile program with a lot of workshops, election security. There were numerous discussions on the coronavirus, and of course that is an issue that is changing on a day-to-day basis. Berks County has been out in front of this. We have been, through our Department of Emergency Services, working with local healthcare providers, local EMS, local fire, local police, the local emergency management coordinators, taking basic common sense approach. Last Friday, we released a memo to all of our department heads. It was a clear directive to the departments that answered directly to Ron Seaman. It was a recommendation to our row officers and a recommendation to our courts. And it basically dealt with 2 things. 1, common sense precautions that you should be taking in your departments. And 2, looking at your continuity of operations material, making sure you understand if you have some people that may potentially be quarantined or whatever the issue may be. Do you understand what the critical areas of your department are so that you can make sure, to the extent possible, those operations are maintained? Our facilities department acted immediately and has worked to make sure they have appropriate supplies on hand and are taking extra effort in the cleaning efforts of the buildings on a daily basis, just making sure surfaces are clean, et cetera. And I can assure you the commissioners are continuing to work closely with our Department of Emergency Services and Ron Seaman. And if you have questions, Ron Seaman is representing the county. We do not want to politicize this. This is about being responsible, being sensible, not trying to stir up panic, but to be responsible. And I am very pleased with what we've done thus far. Brian Gottschall, head of our Department of Emergency Services, is our source expert, and he has been on this, on top of this since day one, communicating with FEMA, the Federal Emergency Management, PEMA, which is Pennsylvania, CDC, all of the healthcare providers and other locals. And he has been on a number of conference calls, one as recently as yesterday. Were you on that call?
No.
You were not.
I got the results.
Okay. Yeah, and I saw that as well. So I just want to let people know what we're doing. We are acting, I believe, with utmost caution, but we're not panicking. We're doing what we think is the responsible thing for county leaders to do relative to the threat of the coronavirus. That's all I have. Comments from row officers? Yes, Sandy.
I would just like to announce that during the month of February, Jack Litton, who was a solicitor for the comptroller's office before my time, and I came on in 2004, he died in Texas last month.
I didn't realize that. I remember Jack. Yes, Jim.
I have a question. You know, one of the things I like best about coming up here is I always learn something. And I'm interested in, to build a single family home, 27% of the cost is in regulation. And to build more than a single home, it's almost 47%, which is real
22,
close to half the cost of building it. Are those costs attributable to local entities or federal entities or state entities that are driving the cost up?
It's a combination of all of them.
Combination of
all. Yeah. Here's to help you. I literally dealt with this issue this morning in a phone call from a builder. Small home needed a site plan, very minimal site plan. It costs $750 to have the engineer do a very basic site plan. Under Act 102, which is a DEP regulation that is enforced at the municipal and county level. Municipal would be through your codes. County specifically is the conservation district. The fee to review it was $900. It is complicated. Now, what Dr. Ben Carson said, and President Trump talked about this, their solution is not getting rid of the regulations. Their solution is looking at the process and seeing what is necessary and what is not necessary. They are not interested in saying, we don't care what happens to air, we don't care what happens to water. But in some cases, and we actually heard from a lady from Florida, where it took 15 years to get a project permitted. 15 years. That's crazy. And that time costs money. It costs money every time an engineer has to go back and make changes. It's insanity. So it is as much an issue of time and process as it is simply a case of too many regulations. And most of these are executed at, in the rest of the country, at the county level. In Pennsylvania, stormwater is enforced by the municipalities. But it's an EPA, an Army Corps of Engineers, federal regulation. comes all the way down, and that's why sometimes we get angry at the wrong people. We get angry at the local supervisors or the local codes enforcement person, when in reality, they're enforcing a reg. In the conservation district, Dean Druckenmiller, they're so frustrated with the DEP, it's called the 102 program and the 105 program, that they and some other districts are thinking about getting out of the program. But here's the problem. If they get out of the program, then you're going to have to go to DEP in Harrisburg to get those 102 permits and 105 permits. And if anybody's ever tried to deal with DEP in Harrisburg, it's an absolute nightmare. So there's some, we do a lot of great things well in America. In regulation is, in many areas, out of control. And it's a web. It's not as simple as saying, I'll pick on Reading. Reading, you need, these are dumb regulations, get rid of them. Most of these regulations that revolve around water, revolve around soil, are not local regulations, they're state and federal regulations, and very complicated.
Amazing. One other question real quick. What is the average cost of a moderately priced home in Berks County?
It will, we'll turn to our realtor, right?
Yeah.
Well, the area that's being looked at and thought of, sought out right now the most is between the range of 120 to 180, 190. The net, when they spoke about affordable housing throughout the United States, they were looking at an average of 150,000 that they felt would be the size home that would fit into working families that are starting out. So, and that's about the same here. So most people here are looking for 120 to 180, and there really isn't much out there at this point.
Are builders not building those types of homes?
No, and I mean, it's, there's a lot that goes into it, but to build a single family home for that price here, it's, or anywhere, it's really not cost effective. Again, all the regulations, not only the cost, but the time that goes into it as well. They have to wait, so that's cost to them as well. If they have a piece of land they can't develop, they're waiting and waiting, that's money that they're losing as well. So right now, instead of looking at single family homes, a lot of the developers are looking at how can we build more on less land. But then you get into zoning issues. So there's a lot of things that, you know, that take into effect as to why there isn't more development of new homes going on right now. And I know property tax is an issue, but that's only part of it. It's not the only reason, it's only part of it.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that.
You're welcome. Public comment. If you could step up, state your name and where you're from.
Jeff Douglas, Exeter Township. Last week we shared an ordinance with you guys that a lot of people would like to see passed. You explained to us in detail, Commissioner Leinbach, happy birthday by the way, that you cannot make a law. Today we are back asking for a resolution. At last count, there are over a third of the counties in our country that have passed this resolution, 1,055 counties to be exact. If done here in PA, Berks would be the fourth county to do so behind Bradford, Cambria, and Huntington. We heard that you don't like resolutions as well because you think it's going to give a false sense of security, but we disagree. There are 25 anti-gun bills currently in PA Senate right now, and our governor just last month called for more strict gun control and red flag laws. We feel the time is now to stand with Article 1, Section 21 of the PA Constitution and let them know that their red flags ain't flying here. Thank you.
Thank you. Other public comment?
Morning, everybody.
Morning.
Good to see you. I'm just here to piggyback on what Jeff said. We did come to you last week with an ordinance. And you explained the reasons why an ordinance wouldn't work, and we agree under the strictures that are there. So we're asking you for a Second Amendment sanctuary resolution. As Jeff said, one of the things that you said in our conversation was that you didn't want to give people a false sense of security. But if you think that you can give gun owners a false sense of security, you're way underestimating exactly what gun owners go through anyway. I am a concealed carry person. I take my gun out every day. It goes on the kitchen counter right next to my wallet and my keys. I have friends who know nothing about guns who think that that gun then becomes animate when it leaves my pocket. And it is looking for somebody to hurt. And it's looking to shoot somebody. They don't understand the way that guns work. They don't understand that if you drop it, it doesn't just automatically fire and find somebody. So when you're dealing with people who have no understanding, which gun owners do all the time, your level of awareness goes up. And so if you think you're going to give us a false sense of security, you think you're way underestimating exactly what we go through every day anyway. So we're going to ask you to join us with this Second Amendment resolution, which I sent to you this morning and have copies of. And we're going to look forward to having a yes vote at some point here in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you. Other public comment? And your name and where you're from.
Peter Schwartz from Burnville. I'm the anchor man to this.
Okay.
And I wanted to point out, I heard your comments earlier about a pending lawsuit because of constitutional rights of people who are accused. I got to tell you, I find that admirable. I was very impressed. As a libertarian, as a Berks County resident, I'm very impressed. And the fact that the commissioners would consider a federal lawsuit against the government to protect the constitutional right of somebody to be considered innocent until proven guilty, that's amazing. But if you're willing to go to the extent of a federal lawsuit to protect the constitutional right of someone who's accused of a crime, why would you not want to simply give a resolution to protect the constitutional right under the Second Amendment of law-abiding citizens to be gun owners? And interesting about the comments regarding mental health and the rights of the accused, red flag laws are currently circulating in the state legislature. A red flag law requires only an accusation. It can be a false accusation. As a matter of fact, in other states, there are mental health professionals who are taking it upon themselves to say they will declare anybody who's a gun owner subject to a red flag law simply because they're a gun owner. Again, why would you not want to simply state a resolution protecting the legal gun owners who have not even been accused of a crime but could be subject to a red flag law simply based on a false accusation that their weapons can be removed from their home when they've done nothing wrong? I just would like for you to consider that when deciding on a resolution. Resolution is a simple thing. As a matter of fact, I would like to propose to you, if a resolution is difficult for the county commissioners to make, perhaps it could be put on a ballot access in November and let the citizens of Berks County make a decision. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Down front here and then Crystal. Again, your name and where you're from.
Okay. I'm Linda Wolfslagel.
You can pull that down.
Oh, yeah. Yes, that's a good idea.
Yep.
Yes. I have a tall personality. Okay. I'm Linda Wolfslagel. I'm the president of Berks Democratic Women, but also I belong to Moms Demand Action. And I personally would love to see this, basically this resolution about the gun sanctuary and Berks. I don't know anything about it. The Moms Demand Action basically are after sensible gun laws to protect people. And the red flags basically was started because abused women were having serious problems with the male cohorts who basically would threaten them with guns. So there are two sides of the story, and I think basically I'd like to see this resolution, and so we could talk to it in a sensible way from the other side. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Crystal.
Oh, thank you. Good morning, Crystal Kowalski of IMSing. So I wanted to comment on President Trump's comment on 65%. Well, I mean, he may not have said the 65% of the jail population has mental health issues.
I was giving our numbers.
You were giving our numbers, okay. But so with our numbers, that 65% of the general population, my assumption would be that there would be some alternative facility built for those people if we were not to have them in prison. And I'm just asking that that alternative facility be a publicly run and owned facility, and that it wouldn't be a gradual privatization of the prison population. Thank you.
Other comments?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Meeting is adjourned.